675LT, and you are now joining me for the start of an entirely new series, which I just decided to start doing. This series is going to be an interview series with iconic people from around the automotive world. I'm titling it Full Chat, and today is my very first interview with someone very special and very influential within the automotive industry. It is none other than Frank Stephenson. He's currently the design director at McLaren, but his back catalogue is incredible. And while he has worked on a few other supercars, arguably some of his more influential and sort of groundbreaking work has been the new Mini, the BMW X5, and the new Fiat 500. You know, cars which have gone on to win award after award. And Frank's going to jump in the car, and we're just going to drive around and have a pretty casual chat about whatever floats his boat, really. Let's do it!
By just hanging onto the bike for, you know,
yeah,
for your life.
Yeah, but so why is it that you gravitated towards cars rather than bikes? Because you spent six years on bikes, and obviously that was a passion, but you ended up going down the
cars route. Just seemed a lot more exotic for me, I guess. When you're a kid, you love bikes. I love them with all my heart.
Yeah.
Sometimes I feel like I design cars just to pay for my bike addiction, you know?
Okay.
But bikes are something that get into your blood. But design, I think when you're designing a car, if you can design a car, you can pretty much design anything in the world.
Okay.
Because if you think about it, a car is more than just the outside of the car.
Of course,
with
yeah,
you're doing the interior, you're doing the materials, you're doing the graphics, you're doing the steering wheel, the seats, everything that you can touch, like a button or knob, whatever, that has to be designed.
Yeah.
As well as the outside of the car, which has to look absolutely, you know, people have to pay good money for a car.
Exactly,
because that's pretty much what drew me, pulled me towards McLaren, was the opportunity to design something from scratch,
design
a brand language.
Must be quite rare, right?
It hardly ever happens. And at the level of McLaren, you know, you'll get offers from kit car companies that are coming in doing a one-off or something. That's okay, but it's not enduring enough, I think. And when you're designing a car for McLaren, that is such a unique opportunity because you have the engineering depth of a Formula One team.
Phenomenal and history to lean back on.
It's just
incredible.
The best. When you come to a company like McLaren where you actually get to initiate the DNA or that design DNA, genetic look or whatever.
Like from day one.
Yeah.
That's just an opportunity. So it's amazing for me to be sitting in and owning a car that you designed from day one. We were talking earlier that you would have liked the 12C from day one to be closer to where the 675 is now.
Yeah.
From day one when I saw this car, I was like, that is it. Like, that is right now, it is arguably the best looking supercar out there.
And thanks.
How did you feel putting out the 12C, sort of knowing that we would have liked to have done this, liked to have done that?
Well, I don't look at it exactly that way. I mean, I look at the 12C as the first building block for McLaren's design language.
Okay.
So not that it wasn't the right car, because I do think it was the right car at the time. When it did come out, it was, it stated that McLaren was serious about building a supercar.
Sure.
They knew how to do it.
Yeah.
The car wasn't overly flamboyant. You know, it was kind of that English understated sort of look, which can't really call a supercar understated, but you can definitely say that it wasn't screaming out like it was wearing a Versace suit, you know?
Yeah, so, it's got like an aura of sophistication about it.
And I think that was very good because it sort of communicated that McLaren was serious and not trying to make a one-off statement with something overly flamboyant.
Yeah.
The second one, the 650, gave us that opportunity to start putting in real unique design elements and starting to make it even more uniquely McLaren and to build the future.
So the story of how I ended up getting this car, I was actually invited out to Tenerife by you guys for the launch of the 570 GT.
Yeah.
And just by chance, my flight the next day got delayed until 7 p.m. It was supposed to be like 12 p.m. and I'm hanging around the hotel and someone came up to me and was like, if you haven't got anything to do, here's the keys to 675 LT. I'm like, all right, great. So I approached it with no expectations. And I drove out in that thing and I was literally 200 yards down the road and I stopped and I thought, hold on a minute, this is a different thing. You know, like I've driven 12C, I've driven 650S. Something about this, I don't know what you've done, but it's greater than the sum of its parts.
You had to
recalibrate. It's such an occasion, man, honestly.
Recalibrate the sensors a bit.
So I went out and I had a 1 hour slot in this car. I said, yeah, I'll be back in an hour and I'll come back. I finished my hour and I'm approaching the hotel to bring the car back. And just as I'm entering the drive, I was like, I'm not quite ready to drop this off. And I turned around and I went off again for an extra hour. So when I got back, the guys weren't best pleased, but apparently I was the third guy during that event to do the same thing.
Yeah, that's a good sign.
I mean, so it's not just me being weird. Like, it when you get in this thing, it sort of affects you, you know? And
yeah, it's an emotional
fabulous
connection, isn't
it?
It's, it's a big wing on the back.
So tell me about the big wing. So, that's if there was ever a claim to fame, you designed the wing on a Cozzy.
It's not a picnic table, as they call it, but I just joined Ford straight out of the university, and of course you have these grand ideas, grandiose ideas of doing something very special, but that project came up, and I thought, well, if I'm going to go for it, I might as well do something pretty dramatic.
Yeah.
And working on the rear wing, I sort of started getting inspiration from the Red Baron, Baron von Richthofen, German. And his plane was one of my favorite planes ever, the Fokker DR1. It was that tri-wing plane.
Yeah.
And I thought, if I can get three wings on the back of this car, because I was in Cologne, Germany,
that's
going to be a Germanic, high-performance-looking vehicle. And which it did start out like that. We had one wing on the deck lid, one wing between, and one upper wing, wow, third wing on the top. And it looked absolutely stunning.
Yeah.
Everybody
so the
loved
original
it.
Cosworth design, mm-hmm, you put forward had three wings.
It had three wings. I'll tell you what happened, which is another painful thing that happens to designers.
Yeah.
You get other people involved who just want to compromise the design, and the bean counters came along and said,
yeah,
we can save quite a bit of money if we get rid of that mid wing. And which they did. So there goes the character of the car. And it's still sold. I mean, obviously the car was pretty successful. But
I guess what people don't see, sort of, it's like an out of sight, out of mind. But the fact that no one's ever seen that concept, they probably think it should be how it is nowadays.
Yeah.
And so when you go about, I mean, if someone came to me and said, we'd like you to redesign an iconic car like the Mini, isn't that quite a daunting thing? To think
well,
that
if you get it wrong,
influence.
If you get it wrong, it's daunting. Because
yeah,
you're just
if you get it right, it's
a major mistake. Yeah, but I mean, like anything else, there's always a logical and an illogical approach to it. I took a very logical approach to it.
Okay.
And you know, there are 15 designers that were working on coming up with their 21st century interpretations of the Mini. So obviously,
15.
Yeah, it's
quite
unheard
a lot,
of.
That's
well,
quite
never,
a lot of...
never before, never again, because it was so expensive to get 15 full-size models of the future Mini out there, but but they had to do that, or they wanted to do that, because they wanted to nail it, basically.
Yeah, yeah, of course.
So there's many different interpretations. But we had a month to design the car, and we had 5 months to get it built by your team of modelers. So it was a six-month process. Well, the Mini, if you understand, it was the same car from when it was launched in 1959.
Yes.
Until 1999 when they ended it.
Yeah.
But those whole 40 years, single body style. So my idea was, if the Mini had changed progressively every 10 years, what would have happened? So my first week of sketching, I designed the 1969 Mini. The second week I did the 79, the third week the 89, and the fourth week, the last week, I designed what I would have interpreted the 1999 Mini. So there was
amazing.
A genetic link.
You know, when you say this, it sounds so obvious, but to think of it that way. Well, interestingly, my first car was
your
a black Mini Cooper with a white roof.
Did you give it a name?
I called it Guinness, because it was black with a white top.
Fantastic.
Yeah. Guinness. so currently, my first and latest car were both designed by you.
Wow.
That's mad. Crazy, man.
Nice coincidence.
So, we've had a brief chat about the exhaust, and it's my favorite story, because you'll never look at the exhaust the same way again. Just
on the
run
Mini.
These guys by, how that came about.
Well, that was probably the most hilarious story ever in car design, from my point of view, obviously. But it was a late night, the night before the big show where we were going to present all the different Mini models to the executive boards of BMW and Rover. So obviously with those 6 months to build the car, there's never enough time to do them. So that last night was an all-nighter pretty much. But we pretty much got finished around midnight with the clay model, the full-size clay model. And if you stand back from those types of cars, those clay models that go into these presentations, they pretty much look real because they're painted with a special material called Dynoc. The glasses areas darkened up. You've got real wheels on the car. So from about 30 meters, 30 yards away, you'd think it was the real thing.
That's real,
So it's about midnight, and the five guys on my team start drinking because we're pretty happy. This was 1994.
Okay.
And we thought, if anybody beats this design, you know, we've got to hand it to them, because this is pretty hot. Still 6 years from launch.
Yeah.
So obviously I'm not much of a drinker, but they were drinking pretty heavily, and about 4 a.m. they were just completely out of it. And I'm thinking, I got to get home and get some rest before the presentation tomorrow morning at 10. So I gave it one last lap around it, and as always, you forget something. I stood at the back of the car, I froze, I started to sweat, thinking, darn it, we forgot to put an exhaust pipe on the car. And I walk up to Colin Lang, the chief modeler, and I said, Colin, darn it, sorry, we forgot to put the exhaust pipe on. He goes, it's only a clay model, it absolutely does not matter, because who's going to look at an exhaust pipe on a model that's still not even out yet?
Right.
I go, Colin, you understand, it's one of the main iconic things on the beauty of the original Mini was this exhaust pipe. back of it. We got to do something. And he's swigging away at a can of Bud. And he goes, well, look, they're completely flat out on their backs. They're not really in any condition to work. And I'm not sure not going to be starting to make an exhaust pipe for you at 4 a.m.
Yeah.
So I said, okay, call an Alto. And I grabbed this beer can. And it's pretty much like any other Coke can or whatever.
Yeah.
I cut it in half.
Yeah.
Threw the top half away, took off the graphics and the paint on the can, so I polished it up to an alloy color. And then you had that little ribbed bottom section to it, and I put a hole in the bottom.
Amazing.
Drilled a hole in, we stuck it in the clay, and we started laughing our heads off because we were looking at the most awesome exhaust pipe we'd ever seen. And okay, so we left it, went into the show the next day, and the car much was a unanimous choice.
Yeah.
And my boss, Chris Bengel, comes up to me and says, congratulations, Frank, great job. It's going to take you far, but never, ever waste a modeler's time making such a detailed exhaust pipe. And I was, you know, a bit embarrassed to tell him.
How long did it take for you to tell him this story?
Well, I never told him it, actually.
Oh, Chris, if you're watching.
But I can't, I wasn't going to tell him. It took me 4 minutes. It was a beer can, so I just nodded, then went back to the drawing board, continued on the Mini until a couple years later.
Fantastic.
The supplier comes up and asks, how would you like the exhaust pipe finisher to be? And I handed him that because I thought, well, this is what I would like it to be.
Yeah.
So he measured it and they produced it. So from 2000 to 2006, that first generation of new Mini had a Budweiser can for an exhaust pipe hanging off the back of it.
That is amazing.
Yes.
I love that story. I love it. So anyone out there watching, if you own a Mini between, what was it, 2000
to 2006.
The 2006, your exhaust is a Budweiser can.
Yeah.
But it does look awesome. So good.
That's fantastic. Best looking exhaust pipe out there, I thought.
Fabulous. Awesome, man. Well, Frank, it's been fantastic. We're now back at MTC. I would like to keep driving you and keep driving all day and talking. But next time you're free, let's get out of the car and
we'll
down
do it again. We'll get on the boat, maybe.
Yeah, absolutely. Dude, to get on the boat would be special. I would like that a lot. Yeah.
It's a real experience. Awesome. Cool.
Frank, thanks a lot, dude.
Pleasure.
Take
man.
Care.
Good.
See you soon.
Yeah, I don't even know where you went. I was trying to think.
Me either,
did you know where you were going?
Not a clue.
No, I just, like, how do we get
I just looped it around and just hope for the best.
It worked out well.